My dear friends, you're all very welcome here to St. Joseph's in Edirne. I welcome all here in the church, and I welcome those of you who are joining us online. And maybe there may be some outside in the church car park listening to our speakers as well. Especially, we welcome the remains of Anna de Benny. We welcome her sons, Vincent and Eamon, their wives Mary and Andrea, her brother Tommy and sister Sadie, her grandchildren, nieces and nephews and relatives and friends of the de Benny and Connolly families. And today we join in prayer in solidarity to say farewell to a faithful Christian, a woman who, in her very quiet yet real way, gave herself to others, especially her family and friends, and who was faithful to her faith and to her God. And we acknowledge that as we begin our Mass by the placing of the lectionary, which contains the Sunday readings, the Sunday scripture readings that we use at Mass, and also a crucifix which was given to us a few weeks ago as a gift. We had a visitor from Bethlehem, and he gave us this little crucifix made of olive, handmade from olive. So we place both of those on Anna's coffin as an acknowledgement of her faith and her whole life as a faithful Christian. Also today, also remember Anna's next door neighbour, Desi Bird, who was laid to rest last Sunday, and Rushing Del Pinto, Balik and formerly of Edirne, who died this morning, and whose funeral arrangements have to be made later. So let us kneel. And we begin in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. And today we commend Anna to God's mercy, but before we begin, we commend ourselves to the same mercy as we say together the Confiteor. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, thoughts and in my words and what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary ever Virgin, and all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord have mercy. Christ have mercy. Lord have mercy. And we pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Anna, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. So now please be seated and we listen to the word of God, and the reading will be read to us, I think, by Liam. Is that Vincent? Sorry.
Yeah. reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the virtuous are in the hands of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace, for if before men indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as their sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. In the time of their visitation, they shall shine and shall move as sparks through stubble. They shall judge nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord shall be their king forever. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. That's the word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, I would have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Dear friends, one of the things that the Benny family and indeed the extended family have impressed on me has been Anna's very firm and consistent faith throughout her life. And this obviously would have been forged as it would have been for many of her generation, and even right down to myself, who came along about a generation later, by a very traditional rural Irish Catholic upbringing. And of course, the catechism that she was taught at school. Indeed, one of the aspects of that traditional catechism, that's the old, well, penny catechism, was the stories of the saints. And I know it's something I got from my mother, and I also got from my primary school teacher, Mrs. McKenna. I learned about the saints and the martyrs, and indeed, when it came to Mrs. McKenna about the martyrs, she didn't spare us the gruesome details. In fact, I left school sort of almost an expert on what being hung, drawn, and quartered meant. But that aside, though, it's still very important that we have heroes to inspire us. Like people in every walk of life, we need these people to speak to us, even if it is from beyond the grave, and to inspire us. Heroes attract us. And it doesn't matter, like I said, all walks of life. If we're into sport, we have our heroes. If we're into music, again, we have those who have inspired us. If we're into literature, again, we'll know of, you know, poets and writers that have influenced us and that we have learned a great deal. And so it is in faith. The saints are our heroes. And we have, of course, the big ones right from the New Testament, the likes of St. Peter, St. Paul, of course, Our Lady, Mary in these days. In the season of Advent, we hear a lot about John the Baptist. And then you go right up to the modern day, the likes of Mother Teresa, Padre Pio, St. John Paul II, to name but a few. These are the big ones that had huge influence. But to be quite honest, you know, as I am now sort of between, I suppose, middle-aged and old-age, the more and more I am drawn to the more obscure saints, the saints that we rarely hear anything about. Because to be quite honest, I realise that I haven't any great achievements behind me. And that is why I'm more and more drawn to these people that we rarely hear anything about. I suppose you might call them the quiet saints. But nevertheless, still spoke to us in their, by their lives, and sometimes in their death as well, spoke to us about Jesus Christ. And indeed, I'd quote two mystics, Anthony de Mello, who was a Sri Lankan priest, who once said, the reason why we miss the saints or don't recognize them is that we look for the extraordinary, but in truth, the real saints are too ordinary to see. Or indeed, the Monaghan poet Patrick Kavanagh, God is in the bits and pieces of every day. Essentially, you know, God is there in the ordinary and the humdrum of life. And that's where we find them, not simply just in the extraordinary people or extraordinary events. I mention that today because when we acknowledge the life and person of Anna de Veni, she was also one of these quiet disciples. And we trust today one of those quiet saints. We take a few moments now to briefly recall the life of Anna. Anna was born on the 20th of April, 1930, to her parents, Frank and Roseanne Connolly, in Newtown Stewart, not far from here. She lived there with her family, leading a quiet and hard-working life, and she got employment in the Sion Mill linen factory, where she spent many happy years and developed close friendships. She married Lawrence de Veni on the 20th of July, 1954, whom she met at a fair. Lawrence, her husband, was working in England, in Huddersfield, and she moved there with him, where she spent the next 63 years. And from their marriage, gave us two sons, Vincent and Eamon. Anna's life was largely focused on her family. Not only did she take great pleasure in rearing her sons, but also helping to raise her grandchildren. However, a few years ago, she decided to move back to Ireland to be near her brother Tommy and sister Sadie. And that brought her to Erin Drive in Edirne, where she's very comfortable in her new home. Anna was a deeply faithful person, and prayer was an important part of her life. Indeed, she came here to Mass. She didn't get, I suppose, a long run at it, because she was only here just over a year when COVID struck, and we went into very quickly into lockdown. But I know that coming here to the church was very important to her. But having said that, she made up for the years. She was provided with a tablet, and she learned to use it. And so she was able to follow Mass on the tablet. However, due to failing health in the last year, she had to receive community care, which she accepted pretty humbly, and went on to develop a close friendship with her carers, who found her very easy to care for and a woman who made very few demands. She loved the companionship. She loved to sit out and chat to people right up to the end, because when I was called down on Sunday, she was still sitting out, and indeed she also was on Monday. And indeed, I wonder, because by that stage she was in such a frail condition. Indeed, you could think of the spirit was very willing, but the flesh weak. When you saw her, I suppose, living her life right to the very end. In the midst of her quiet and gentle nature, she was still a very tough and resilient person. Anna will be sadly missed by her loving family, and indeed by the entire family circle. But we also say goodbye to her, confident as a person of faith, she is now one with the Lord. To Vincent and Eamon, Mary and Andrew, Tommy and Sadie, her grandchildren, nieces, nephews, and all relatives and friends of the De Veni and Connolly families, on behalf of all here in the parish of Kilmainne, I offer to you our deepest sympathies. May her soul and all the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. And now again, I ask you to please stand, and Vincent, Dave will come forward and lead us in the prayers to faithful. Where is this? Sorry, there's been a change of plan. This is Liam. Lord, we now turn to you in our bidding prayers as we seek your help and support in our grief.
Lord, remember today your servant Anna. Now that her suffering and trials in this world are over, she may live forever in peace and mercy of your kingdom. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Remember Anna's sons, Vincent and Eamon, their wives, Mary and Andrea, her brother Tommy, sister Seda, her grandchildren, nieces, nephews, and all relatives and friends. Help them in their grief and sorrow, and maybe they be consoled by their memories of Anna and by their faith, which assures them that she is at peace. Lord, hear us. Remember all our deceased relatives and friends, especially Anna's husband, Lawrence, and her brothers, Jim and Joe. May they be enjoying light of your presence and shared in your glory. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all the doctors and nurses, and especially for the carers who looked after Anna so lovingly. May they be rewarded for their kindness in enabling Anna to live in comfort and dignity in her final days. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all in the church and humanity at this difficult time to help all to have hope and lead us through this pandemic and all of the troubles. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. And we pause for now for a few moments in silence. If any of us have any personal intentions, we, in the silence of our own hearts and minds, we make them known. Lord, hear us. Lord, we ask you to be close to all of us today and all humanity. As we commend your servant Anna to your mercy, remember her family and all her relatives and friends. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. pray now, my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Anna, we beseech your mercy, that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful Judge, who lives and reigns for ever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life has changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. You're indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts you have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. And therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse and our patron, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, Saint Anna, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Larry, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen to the prayers of this family, whom you have called before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Anna, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that she who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth you will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours forever and ever. So now at our Saviour's invitation and challenged by his divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, and thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. We just pause for a moment and we pray for peace, since we cannot, under current circumstances, make the sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Please kneel. And just before we enter the rite of Holy Communion, just then people are familiar with what we do here. First of all, because of the COVID restrictions, you can only receive Holy Communion on your hand. So you're not accustomed to do that. Put out your hand like that there. And if you want to come forward, if you feel you can't receive Holy Communion, you can receive a blessing by making that sign when you come forward for Holy Communion. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. We pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Anna may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns for ever and ever. Amen. Dear friends, just before we conclude Mass, we will now, in a few moments, have the rite of final combination and farewell, and afterwards Anna's remains will be brought to her place of burial alongside her husband Lawrence in Castle Finn. But before we do so, first of all, I would like to thank the Venny and the extended family for all your help, because funerals these days are difficult for all, and especially for those of you who have to travel. With things being so uncertain, indeed, it's obvious that the situation, both with yourselves in England, indeed here in Edinburgh as well, the situation in relation to COVID is deteriorating. But again, thanks very much, and indeed I commend you for, making an extraordinary effort under difficult circumstances to be here today. I would like to thank Chanel Mullen for the lovely singing and the music, and to thank our sacristan Eileen Montague, and our undertakers Claude and Patsy, and indeed in going back to the Venny family, to thank Vincent and Liam for the readings, and apologies about the little bit of confusion, but maybe your mother might have a wee smile at it. So we stand for the rite of final combination and farewell. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. And we now pray in silence, and before Anna's body leaves the church, we will reverence the body with holy water, which is a reminder of baptism, and with incense, which again is an ancient sign of reverence and sacredness, and also has the symbolism of the smoke rising, similar to our prayers rising to heaven.
the response to the prayer is, receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Saints of God, come to her aid, hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. In your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister Anna in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Anna in this life. They are signs, those, of our goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and our sister forever. Amen. In peace, let us take our sister Anna to her place of rest in Castlefin.